Hello everybody, welcome back to my educational blog, It is English Literature. I am Ardhendu De. Today, we are going to learn why plot is called the soul of tragedy. We will try to understand Aristotelian constituent parts of tragedy from poetics, particularly plot. Out of six constituent parts of tragedy that Aristotle speaks of, in which plot is the most vital and important one, we will carry out a discussion on that topic. Aristotle has told us that there are six constituent parts of tragedy: plot, character, thought, diction, song, and spectacles. The most important of these is the plot. The structure of the incident, the arrangement of things, how it is done, this is all the plot about. Aristotle has subordinated the other elements to plot because he conceives the tragedy as an imitation, not of man and its character, but of actions and of life. And as life consists in action, so plot is the primary one. Because plot is the underlying principles of a tragedy, the very soul of it. Plot gives meaning, vigor, and vitality to the play. So, while putting a discussion on how to make this plot beautiful, it is, in fact, Aristotle is giving the marketing strategy of how to make a tragedy successful one. Even though Aristotle's poetic has been composed after Sophocles' death 50 years beyond, but he has seen the very strategy of dramatists of his time and how they perform, what is the most attracting part and how it pulls the audience and how it make an arresting principles, how a popular tragedy can be saved. So in his ideology, he gives an explanation that plot comes first because plot is in fact a sum total of actions that are being performed on stage and how these actions are minutely given in coherent whole in a beads by beads, how it becomes full garland and how it can be presented to the audience is the very important one. But before we come into discussion into plot, let's discuss few words what the character is and what thoughts and dictions and song and spectacles are all about. Aristotle has defined the very catalogue of identifying a perfect tragedy. In search of perfect tragedy, he dissects all those available resources in front of him, the three great triumvirates of then time, Sophocles, Aeschylus and Euripides, and analyzing their plays, he finds out some principles and that principles are noted down in his poetics. He says the characters are the sum total of those men and women who pops up in the theme of the play and acts on stage. So the character, it means that has a definite words to say and definite action to perform. So in the part of characters, we can find out both human characters, divine characters, as well as some of the characters which are supernatural beings. In thought content, he says that the very ideologies or ideas that comes out as a sum total of the words that are being uttered by the characters on stage are the very thought. The thoughts are the very prime or sublime prospect of thinking. It cannot be a gross one, it cannot be a difficult one, it can be a platform of ideas which the dramatist has to put forward to his audience and make a sensible meaning out of it. The audience should comprehend it, release it, and the dramatic purposes are fulfilled. The diction is simply the words or the choice of the words and its full meaning, and it's the exhibition of that meaning through utterances by the characters is the sum total of diction, he says. And the songs, the music, the performances of the music and the spectacles are the sum total of the shows or the presentation as a whole. So out of all these, he puts a concentration on plot and makes a meaningful rendering why the plot should be forwarded out of these six elements. So being a student of literature, you must have to comprehend these six parts separately. Nothing to get complicated. Out of these five elements that I have given a short explanation, the plot comes pivotal, plot comes important, because plot is coherently attached to each and every spectacle, every sphere of these elements. If there is no plot, why the characters should happen? If there is no connective plots, the characters should not grow. If there is no connective plots or a coherent plot, there is no thought ensues. If there is no plot at all, what the character should say and who listen to? So the diction is useless. Even though songs and performances can be interpolated, but without plot, nobody will take an interest on song. It should not be a tragedy proper. And the spectacles, only by the spectacles one cannot fool the audiences. And the performances of the characters, performances of the playwright and everything all depends upon how he make the plots or how he make the entirety of the actions in part by part, coherently knit them and making a full circle of a design. A design that puts forth, that elementarily exhibits a meaningful way of telling some views or showing something which the audience has not seen before. So plot comes the pivotal point. But what Aristotle says and how Aristotle gives this plot such an importance is the prime discussion here. So by categorically, I will analyze why he has given such an importance on plot. While defining tragedy, Aristotle says, tragedy is an imitation of some action that is serious, complete, and of a certain magnitude. So what he says by these words? By the word serious or serious action, Aristotle means a tale of suffering that should extract pity and fear. I think you have gone through the word pity and fear many of times in discussing tragedy. So in a tragedy, the plot should depict a hero who has been passing from happiness to misery, and not the other way around. A tragedy with happy ending or a flippant action, if we say, will not arouse the emotions of pity and fear. As you know, the main arresting factor is pity and fear. The specific function of a tragedy is pity and fear, or extracting pity and fear. Aristotle says our pity is excited by or extracted from misfortune, suffering. Our fear is resemblance between sufferers and ourselves. So fear is the concept that if we do such foul actions, we will be pitiful. Our fear by some resemblance between sufferer and ourselves. So if we do some foul actions, there should be some fearful rendering in us, that if we commit such things, it will be a fearsome aspects. Next, as Aristotle points out, the tragic plot must be complete or self-content with a beginning, middle and an end. The plot assumes a beginning that promises further action. A middle leads to both previous and succeeding action. It connects, and the end, it requires preceding events but no further action. So ends should inevitably end, logical end. That inevitable and logical conclusion should be there in the plot at the end part. This kind of artistic arrangement or logical link up is very essential. If the tragic incidents are to be consistent, harmony and coherent in a manner it can be presented, then it is a plot or a tragic perfect plot, otherwise not. So what Aristotle says about the order and wholeness of the tragedy is connected closely with what he says about its magnitude, the third word he says, the size or length. It should not be too small, it should not be too longer either, but just in proportion. If it is too short, the mind of the reader or the spectator will miss many things to comprehend it fully. And if it is lengthy one, it will not be easily taken in as a whole by, roughly speaking, the magnitude of the plot should be sufficient to allow the hero to pass by a series of probable or necessary stages from happiness to misfortune. And that probable time of passing should be enough for the reader or spectator to comprehend it. So magnitude also implies order and proportion, as in a case of living organism. Beauty and symmetry depend upon the sizable and reasonable sizes in all parts, in all proportions. A reasonable length or size is essential for the condition of beauty. If you see in the fashion design, there is the probable and comprehensible size that makes something beautiful. The principles of right size is aesthetic and utilitarian. Aesthetic in that sense that it should not be such an extreme as monstrous and horrible. Utilitarian in that concept that it should not be too large or too small. Unimaginable or unseen, uncomprehendable thing should not be there. The utility of action, as Aristotle so strongly emphasizes, the very characteristic of an organic plot, that one action should be compressed into many actions. Not all in the life of a hero, which are essentially and intimately connected with one another and appear together as a whole. So, the actions that are to be shown on stage should be related to the hero's life, and it can touch every man's life. But these everyman life type actions, unless they have something to do with tragedy that befalls him, they are relevant to the plot and will have to be kept out. So unessential things, even though it is related to the hero, should be omitted. For a thing whose presence or absence make no visible differences is not an organic part of the whole. So which thing should be part of the incidents, which should not be the part of tragic incidents, is to be designed out by the very artist or the very dramatist. There should be variety of incidents, episodes, which constitute the fabric of the plot. The plot is composed of various episodes, but their structural unison is such that any of them, if any of them is displaced or removed, the whole will be disjointed and disturbed. So, in the plot is like that of a structure of bricks. One is pulled out, the whole of the structure should be scrambled. Episodic plots which lack the essential logical connection of events are the worst of all. That's why the plot should be coherently attached. It should be interconnected with each other. In such kind of plot construction where the episodes do not follow one upon another and the law of probability, law of necessity is not followed, is not the plot proper according to Aristotle. So, how a plot can be connected? What are the adhesive quality? What are the connecting links of these plots? So Aristotle gives us a theory that is the theory of unities, the unity of action, time and place, the three unities. But here the problem ensues that many of the critics and many of the readers have not comprehended the three unities properly. In the question of time, Aristotle does not say such a connective links, that it should have been no such limited time, but a complete whole of the time should have been a probability, that a full circle of the or full revolution of the sun, that means a whole day, but such is not followed properly. About the unity of place, Aristotle nowhere says anything that the stage should not present or represent such thing or such not thing. He is simply stating a normal practice that the dramatic of that time presented. But the confusion comes up that what should be the unity of times, unity of place and action should be. But the unity of places is that such places should not be there in the theme of discussion, which is not comprehensible to go there. But what comes pivotal point is the unity of action. That unity of actions, it is attached to plot. That unity of, if there is no unity of actions, then the plot will scramble down, plot will be broken. So he put full trace on unity of actions instead of unity of place and unity of time. He says unity of time and place should be a parallel way that is comprehensively and logically presented. But what is most relevant is the unity of action. Aristotle has pointed out that the incidents of the plot should be keeping with the law of probability and necessity. The two words. The improbable things have no such practical capability of representing the plot or actions logically. And unnecessary things are like that of a flashy things, it should be removed. So the rule of probability, and that can be attached with the rule of necessity, the internal structure of the tragic poem, its inner law that secures the cohesion of the parts, is the very key feature of plot structure. The concept of necessity implies if such a such person exists, if such a such circumstances happened, and related such and such things and related such and such characters, then he must act in such and such manner. So these so many interrelated things should be there, and that is the connectivity, intertwined laws that makes a plot understandably forwarding. Thus, whatever is said, acted by the character on stage should be creditable, should be credible, convincing, and irrespective of its impossibility. Even though impossibility is imposed some of the cases, but the creditable presentation should be there. Aristotle is stating that impossibility is to be preferred to an unconvincing possibility, and that is the artistry. So if you find so many ifs and buts which is not probable, such is the ghost scene, such is the divine scenes, but your question should be subsidized, question should be minimized when you find the logic behind presentations of this. So the plot may be simple or complex, which he means that the hero's fortunes takes place without peripeteia or anagnorisis by complex action, one that involves either of the two or both. So the complexity of the plot is the way in which the tragic hero meets his final blow. It might be difficult way, it might be a shortcut, it might be a simple way. Aristotle traces that both these should arise from the structure of the plot itself, so as it is to be necessary, probable consequences of what has gone before. Peripeteia, or that is recognition or discovery. He used this word. By reversal of situation, he again uses another term, that the reverse of intention it might be, a deed done in blindness defeating its own purpose. It is indeed a change into the reverse of what is expected from the course of action. So the example is suitably, or the example Aristotle finds in front of him, is the world famous Oedipus, the opposite state of things. That very scene when the messenger has just come to congratulate Oedipus and resume his fears with respect to his mother reveals the secret of birth. But by recognition or discovery is implied a change from the ignorance to knowledge happening between those characters who are to lead the action to its catastrophe. The finest form of anagnorisis is one of the accompanies peripeteia, such as occurs in Oedipus. Both peripeteia and anagnorisis please the audience because there is an element of surprise in them. Combined together, they give rise either to pity and fear, which tragedy assumes to represent. So it boldly affirms, the plot boldly affirms the complexity through different categories, but the prime focus is to represent pity and fear. So in Aristotelian words, if I say that a perfect tragedy should be arranged not on a simple but on complex plot. Complexity of the plot is not its intricate design, rather its intricate thought design. or in its intricate interlocking intertwined plot. That is the very realism. Since the purpose of the tragedy is to represent a kind of pity and fear, how it can be presented, how or which incident should cause pity and fear, and that possible cause is to be organized in the works or in the structure of the plot. Pity and fear may be aroused by spectacular means such as torture, piteous lamentation, beggarly appearance, so on, but a good plot should be so constructed that even without the aid of the eye, he who hears the tale, even if it is audio medium, will be filled with horror and pity at what takes place. When a disastrous deed is perpetuated by an enemy upon enemy, there is nothing to arouse our pity and fear. But whenever the deed is done within a family, when the murder of or the like is committed or meditated by the brother on brother, by son on father, by mother on her daughter or on her son, or the son on his mother, and these are the situations of which a tragedian should take advantage in order to arouse a certain kind of emotions, and that emotions are pity and fear, and these are the elementary features that should one tragedian exercise while representing his dramatic technique or dramatic verses. So Aristotle further put a discussion what kind of plot or what are the definition or how plot can be devised. And he further says that plot can be divisible into two parts, complications or its unraveling or denouement, entirety of the plot, how it complicates and how it unraveling. The complication is that ties the events into a tangled knot, the latter unities or latter those knots are untied. The complication includes all the actions from the turning point where it takes a turn for good or ill. The denouement extends from the turning point to the end. The first, we all know, is the rising action. The second, denouement, is the falling action. Each and every plot should have these two basic, upward journey and downward journey. Aristotle enters into such a comprehensive and penetrative discussions of this kind of particular designing of the plot in terms of its structure that he regards the groundwork, the design, the medium, the ethos, that means character, and its meaning and its dramatic presentation all should be in structurally cohesive and structurally straightforward. So he puts a maximum stress on plot construction. In classical dramas, we find well-knit and coherent plot. Most probably these are the examples by which Aristotle writes his poetics. Characters, they are secondary. But in the romantic tragedies, the dictum of Aristotle is turned upside down. Marlowe, Kyd wrote many arresting tragedies in which plot construction is nothing, minimum. but they are interesting because of their scrupulous life-like characterization. So Shakespeare, our greatest dramatist, he also emphasizes on characterization than on plot constructions. Under the plot, Hollinson's Macbeth and Shakespeare's Macbeth is nothing so different. But Hollinson's Macbeth or its characterization is far away minimized, or Shakespeare's Macbeth is far away dramatized, far away critical, far away a psychic journey rather than of Hollinson's. So this maturity is there. This evolution is there. So plots or Aristotle principles of understanding the plot, I have put a discussion on it. So you can carry out this discussion to get a complete meaning of what Aristotle says. But you must have to remember one thing, that Aristotle takes this all examples from his classical examples in front of him. And beyond that, the principles of what should be the tragedy, what should be the tragic design. So many things are right, so many things are not right, so many things are logically said, so many things are not logically said, or being there are plenty of things that can have a argument there. So in understanding Aristotle's poetics, in understanding Aristotle's definitions of plot, what we must say, that what Aristotle says, that plot is the prime one. One tragedy should not be a tragedy without any plot. These things are correct, but it is not correct that without plot, or without having a connective plot, or without having a strong plot, even though there is characters, even though there are such dramatizations of with other technicalities, a drama or a exquisite tragic drama can be presented. So Aristotle's discussions on poetics, Aristotle's discussions on plot is an open-ended discussions. We need collective understanding what plot is and how it can be understood in relations to beautification, or its rectified, or its beautified presentations on stage. So I think this discussion will enrich your understanding of plot or Aristotelian plot. I have tried my best to explain it in simple languages. If you have any questions regarding plot and Aristotle's definitions on this particular criteria, you can pop up any questions here. I will try my best to give such answers, and the discussion will continue further. So stay tuned. Bye bye. Like, share and comment.